Several control charts, the simplest one or the widely used one is X bar R chart. Today I would like to touch all the charts, not only the control chart for variables, but also the control chart for attributes. And only thing is, you must allow me to move on very quickly by answering the questions I am going to ask in between. So if I get the answers, then I will move fast. If I don't get answer, my habit is I will talk more about it, and then time will be lost. All right. So first is X bar R chart. All right. So the basics of control chart, it's always good to begin from the basics, and then theory of variability, and then what is this X bar R chart, and one important chart from attribute data is our P chart. And but I have examples from all the charts. We'll see. So generally, a control chart will look like this. All of you could have seen it, right? A control chart will have three lines, a center line, and a control limit, and two lines. You see the center line in green color, and a control limit, upper control limit, and a lower control limit in red color. So generally, the control limits, as we know from the normal distribution, as we know, the distance of the control limit from the center line will be 3 sigma units, right? The distance of the control limit from the center line will be 3 sigma units. Can somebody tell me what is the chance for your point to fall inside control limit? What is the probability for a point to fall inside the control limit?
99.73.
Wow, beautiful. 99.73% of chance is there for your point to fall inside the control limit. If that is not happening, what is our understanding? An event which is having a very low probability is happening. When an event having a very low probability is happening, can't you consider that as a special event? Yes, it is a special event. So your process requires your attention. Your process is giving you a signal that, gentlemen, my process is producing output which is abnormal. Anything within 3 sigma limit is normal. Anything beyond a 3 sigma limit is considered abnormal. Why? Because within 3 sigma limit, the probability is 99.73, but beyond 3 sigma level, the probability is very less, right? And that's the thing. And now the center line, upper control limit, and lower control limit, and look at the points. Here, one point is below the lower control limit. That means this process is not normal. Not normal means it is out of control. When a process is out of control, what we need to do is we need to first bring it under our control. It is something like, how we grow our child. Same way we need to, grow our process also. For child is doing certain wrong things. What we do? We try to control the child, isn't it? We try to control the child and then see to that the child doesn't do it again. Same way, whenever your process is producing outputs beyond a control limit, you must immediately improve the process, right? You must improve the process. Improving the process is, there are two stages. First stage, you must get all the points inside the control limit. If you get all the points are falling inside the control limit, it simply means process started listening to you. It means process started listening to you. That means you have really good control over the process. And now you try to improve further. Whether you want to shift the mean or you want to shift the control limit, that is called process improvement. Am I right? My profit is 100 crores. I want 120 crores. That means what? I am shifting the mean. That from 100 crore, I want to jump to 120 crore. That means I am shifting the mean. Another thing, my customer wants 100 mm. Now I will produce everything around 100 mm. How can I do it? I produce 10,000 units. I will produce all 10,000 units exactly 100 mm. Exactly 100 mm means very close to 100 mm. That is possible when I bring the control limit too close to the center line. Isn't it? When I can push my control limit too close to the center line, it means in real world, it simply means everything I produce are around the target. Now I am able to improve the quality. So what is that you want to achieve? definitely your control limit can give you clear direction. Sorry, your control chart can give you clear direction. So what is the use of a control chart? Actually, the control chart is a tool introduced by a statistician called Walter Shewhart. We all know Walter Vetrivel, right? Similarly, control chart is introduced by Walter Shewhart. He is an engineer. He is a statistician. He has worked for Bell Laboratories in US. And in 1920s, he wanted to implement his statistical concept in manufacturing process. And so he like how all of us know that 99.73 will be inside control limit, he also know 99.73 will be inside control limit. So he developed this tool, which is called control chart. And he started using it for monitoring and controlling the manufacturing processes. So control chart helps us in three ways. Number one, it helps us to monitor the stability. You have a house. Your house should be stable, isn't it? Stability is very, very important for a structure. If the stability is good, maybe you can construct one more floor. You can construct another floor. So stability is the basis. Similarly, if you want to improve any process, you must first of all make sure your process is producing the results in a stable manner. Right? So it helps you to monitor the stability. And the same control chart can help you to determine the readiness for improvement. If your process is consistently producing parts within the control limit, you can understand your process is giving you a signal that it is ready for the next level of performance. It is ready for the next level of performance. The next level of performance can happen by two ways. One is shifting the mean. Another one is moving the control limits closer to the center line. When I shift the mean, my results will be greater. When I move the control limit closer to the target, my consistency will be at its best. All my outputs will be closer to the target. Both are important in any business, right? So you can use control chart to understand whether your process is really ready for the next level of performance or not. And control chart can also be used as a visual validation tool. I plot control chart before improvement and after improvement. Before improvement, my control chart is like this. Lot of points are outside the control limit. Before improvement, my control limits are wider. Right? Before improvement, my center line is 100 crore. But after improvement, all the points are inside the control limit. After improvement, my control limits are not wider. They are very close to the center line. After improvement, my center line is on 120 crores. These are all visual evidence, visual validation, isn't it? You can also use a control chart to quickly convince anyone. Look at the process, how it is before. Now I joined the company. Now I am taking care of the same process for 1 year. Now look at the same process, how I am running. You can quickly convince your boss. It's a visual validation, right? And now for you to master the control chart, you must have a clarity on difference between common cause and special cause. If some of you tell me, what is the difference between a common cause and special cause, then we can quickly move the slides. All of you are familiar with the common cause or special cause, or you want me to talk about it? When do you say a cause is special? When do you say a cause is common? Any answers to this question?
Can I, sir?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, common cause is normal cause when we cannot identify from our natural process, and special cause we can identify something is going to beyond from our control limit. Something we can assign, something and we can trigger. That is a special cause. And apart from that, which is beyond from our human control, is common cause only.
Beautiful. Variation is, yeah. Yes.
Is special cause may be told CTQ also?
No. The common cause and special cause are both applicable to our CTQ, critical to quality. The center line represents CTQ. It could be diameter, it could be profit, it could be rejection, it could be defectives, it could be anything. It should be cycle time, it can be lead time, it can be the number of students getting enrolled for my program. Everything, anything can be monitored in a control chart. The center line is CTQ. What is important to you, that is center line. And what is important to you should also be under your control. batch on batch, if we get 20 people, then company can run smoothly. All of a sudden the numbers drop down, then company cannot exist, isn't it? So anything we wanted to keep the results consistent. If possible, we will try to shift the mean. Shifting the mean may require effort, some enormous effort. Process improvement is required. All right. So there are two things: common cause and special cause. Always variation is the problem. Control chart actually monitors the variation, right? If you are able to explain the reason for the variation, if you are able to assign a specific reason for the variation, that is called a special cause variation. If you are not able to explain the reason for the variation, that is called common cause variation. Can somebody tell me what time we started the meeting? We announced it at 8:00. Can somebody tell me what time we started the meeting? What time? 8:00 or 8:05?
8:05.
So now 8:05 is different from the targeted value of 8.
Yes, sir.
Do you think this variation is abnormal or is it normal?
Normal.
It's normal. So you don't need, you don't react much. So 5 minutes, it's well within the limits, well within the tolerable limits. So you call it normal. Suppose I don't start the session up to 8:30. Half an hour, all are waiting. Now, definitely, situation will become abnormal. And then you will start asking me the question. For the 5 minutes, none of you ask me the question. Sir, why you did not start? But when I keep quiet for half an hour, then you can't keep quiet, isn't it? You will start asking me, why are you not starting? Then why did you call us for 8:00? Right? So situation becomes, situation changes. A reason for the variation exists. If a reason for the variation exists, that is called a special cause. If there is no variation, no reason for the variation exists. For example, for 5 minutes and all, I cannot give a reason. It will happen just like that, isn't it? Every time we start the meeting, we have to wait for people to join. We have to get introduced and something we do. And that is a common cause. So whenever you are not able to explain the reason for the variation, that is common cause. But if a reason exists, that is called special cause. How can I know it by looking at my sample? How can I know it by looking at my number? If your number is far away from the target value is nothing but the center line. Center line, right? If your number, if your sample is far away from the center, you can understand situation is changing from an common cause to special cause. And the borderline is your control limit. Borderline is your control limit. All right. So imagine, I am monitoring your travel time. I'm monitoring your travel time from your house to office. You are going by bike. From your house to office, you are going by bike. I monitor your time for continuously 5 days. And for 5 days, the time is like this, 40 minutes. That means on an average, you reach office in 40 minutes. All right. And now you are seeing a variation here. This variation is unexplainable. Can I say? I can't explain the reason for variation. If somebody asks you, if your boss asks, hello, why do you came two minutes late today? Then you will not mind to answer that question, isn't it? Because even if your boss uses the bike and comes, he will also might take some variation. There will be. So whatever variation you are seeing here, this is a common cause variation. Each number is almost very close to the average. Average is center, which is 40. But what happened one day? You reach office very early. You took only 25 minutes. And now I'm asking you, why did you come so early? Do you think you will have an answer now?
Yes, sir.
You might say, there is no traffic on the road. It's a lockdown. So only I am the only person driving the bike. So instead, generally it takes 40 minutes, but today it took only 25 minutes. A solid reason exists. A special reason exists. So this number is an indication of a special cause. We all must be very good in listening to the numbers. The data can speak to us. The data can speak to us. So if we could understand what the data is speaking to us, then we can take wise decision in our business process. Another day, you took 55 minutes to reach the office. Is it a common cause or a special cause?
Special cause.
And the special cause is rain. That particular day it is raining, so you have slowed down. Another day you took 1 hour 40 minutes. Is it a common cause or a special cause?
Very special cause.
Because you have met your girlfriend on the way, so you spent 1 hour in a coffee shop, and so you took 1 hour 40 minutes, right? So now you understand what is the difference between a common cause, and this is common cause, this is special cause, this is special cause, and this is very special. All right. So all of you understand the difference between common cause and the special cause. So, right. There are two types of variation. One is common cause variation, a process that is operating with only chance cause of variation. Chance cause, normal cause, random cause, common cause. These are all same. Random means normal. Normal means chance. Chance means common. These are all same, right? Only English. If a process that is operating in the presence of assignable causes, in the presence of assignable causes, it is said to be out of control. Your child is doing the mistake knowingly. That is a serious problem, right? Your child is doing a mistake knowingly. That's a serious problem. But unknowingly, no, that's fine. That we can tolerate. But this is serious. And now, control chart is helping us to understand the stability in the process. Stability means we must get all the points inside the control limit. This is very important. This is the beginning of, you know, the process improvement. If stability is there, then you can improve the capability. And capability we measure in terms of sigma level, we measure in terms of DPMO, we measure in terms of yield, we measure in terms of CPCPK, or you measure it in any way. My profit from 100 crore to 120 crore, that is also sigma level. That is also an improvement, right? So process improvement means either I will be moving the mean or I will be moving the control limit. Please try to move the mean. Please try to move the control limit. Only when you are able to get all the points inside the control limit. If your child is listening to you, if your child is in a mood to obey you, then you try to improve. Child is not at all obeying you. First of all, you must make him obey, isn't it? Then you give advice. If your child is not obeying you, you keep on giving a lot of advice. Do you think that will be helpful? Not helpful, right? So first of all, gain the stability to gain the capability. If you are struggling in terms of stability, your immediate goal should be on the stability. If you get few points falling outside the control limit, how many of you are dare enough to stop the process? We need to stop the process because something, you know, becoming abnormal. Your ECG report, a peak comes. That should be, you know, given importance, isn't it? Your ECG rhythm, suddenly one point is, you know, going very much upward or very much downward. High BP, low BP. That has to be looked at seriously. If you don't look at it seriously, then process can collapse, right? So we have to be very careful. That is what the control chart is doing. So a process is under statistical control. Now tell me what kind of variations it will have. Will it have common cause variation, or will it have random cause variation, or will it have unassignable cause of variation, or do you think all the statements are correct? Process is under statistical control. Now pick your choice.
All are correct.
All are correct.
Very good.
All are correct.
All are correct, right? If you see all the points inside the control limit, you can understand common clause alone is playing. No special cause, right? That is the meaning of process under control. But once you become matured enough, you can suspect special cause even if all the points are inside control limit. That we will talk towards the end of the session, right? Right now, only one signal. all the points inside the control limit. An out of control process will always have, can you fill up the statement? An out of control process will always have dash.
Special cause.
Special cause.
Beautiful. An out of control process will always have special cause. But I'm going to give you an option like this. Now, what is your option? Is it number one or number two or number three?
Number three.
When there is number three, the number three is the best option. Because always, always common cause will be there. I take your ECG report, always it will go up and down. I cannot eliminate that. If I could eliminate that also, then there is no life. Isn't it? So for life to exist, there has to be some random motion. So that is there, that will be there. So if a process is out of control, definitely it will have assignable cause in addition to common cause. We can always improve a process which is statistically out of control. Do you believe you can improve a process which is statistically out of control? Your child is not obeying you. Do you think you can still improve him?
No, I'm not making control.
Difficult, right? First of all, we must make the child obey to us. Then you advise. Then it will happen, right? So this is the strategy. And if a process is statistically out of control, what should be our immediate goal? Is that your goal will be statistical process control or your goal will be statistical process improvement?
Statistical process improvement.
Process control, right?
Process control.
No, see, improvement in the sense result has to improve. Improvement in the sense your quality should improve. That is possible in two ways. You can shift the mean or you can shift the control limit. But for that to happen properly, your process should be in statistical process control. That is not there. See, when the process is out of control, no improvement, no baseline study also you should not do. Please take it granted. Many of you are doing the baseline study, isn't it? You calculate CPCPK or you want to understand, no, this is the performance. You are saying that my company, the turnover is 2 crore. When I say turnover is 2 crore, it means, you know, the turnover is plus or minus 2 crore. It is not 10 crore and it is not, you know, 10 lakhs. That is the meaning. When I say 2 crore, it means 2 crore plus or minus 0.1 or 0.2. That is okay. So when your process is statistically out of control, first of all, you must standardize. Standardization comes into picture here. And when you standardize your process, your results will become consistent. And then you go for the improvement. All right. So we'll discuss a case now. See, I have some numbers here. These numbers are nothing but length of a product. The product is camshaft. The camshaft length is measured. And those of you who are in the service industry, for you, the numbers may not be length. The numbers may be, let's say, the processing time. The customer places an order and you process it and finish it in 600 minutes. You are handling a big team of 10, you are handling 4 or 5 team. And all the 4 or 5 team have to see to that. They process it in 600 minutes. But so what happened? Some team taking more time, some team taking less time. On the manufacturing side, this is length of a product. The length required is 600. Going above is also a problem. Coming below is also a problem. So you wanted to monitor the length. So you decided to collect the samples. You have a data collection plan. You have to set a data collection plan. Now data collection plan is, you have decided to collect the data for continuously 5 days. And every day, there are 4 shifts in the company. You have decided to collect the data from all the 4 shifts. On shift number 1, you collected 5 data. On shift number 2, you collected another 5. That means in a day, you collect 20 data. Similarly, 5 days, you have collected 100 data. And now the samples are collected on 20 occasions. Samples are collected on 20 occasions. This is the first occasion, second occasion. And what is this? This is the 20th occasion. That means there are 20 subgroups. That means there are 20 subgroups. And inside each subgroup, I have 5 data. That is called subgroup size. That is called subgroup size. Now 100 data available, data collection is done, and then data is collected, and now you calculate the x bar. How many subgroups you have? 20. Now can you calculate 20 x bar value? What is x bar? Average. Every subgroup has got 5 data. You calculate the average, and then every subgroup has got 5 data. You also calculate range. So how many range you will get? 20 ranges you will get. Why do I calculate x bar and why do I calculate range? I wanted to monitor the average. I wanted to monitor the range. Always, for you to understand any process, only two things you need to understand. One is central tendency, another one is variation. Central tendency can be understood by looking at average, median, or mode. And now we are using median, we are using mean, because my data is continuous. When my data is continuous, I will use average. Average is the best central tendency. And then here, for understanding the variation, I use range. Why not standard deviation now? Because my subgroup size is only 5. Subgroup size is only 5. Now calculating standard deviation may not give me a close picture. So I will calculate range, and then I will monitor range. So range should be considered as the measure of variation whenever your subgroup size is less than 8. And then I calculate x double bar. What is x double bar? Average of the averages. Average of the averages. How many averages you have? 20 averages you have. And then compute R bar. How many ranges you have? 20 ranges. Can you calculate average of the ranges? That is R bar. These are all simple things which, anyway, Minitab will take care of everything. But you must know before using any software, right? And then compute the control limit. We all know what is the distance of control limit from the center line? 3 sigma. But unfortunately, I cannot measure sigma here. Why? Because the number of data is less. But I have measured range. So range can be converted into standard deviation. Range can be converted into standard deviation. By experience, people found that the standard deviation, or the 3 times standard deviation, will be equal to D3 into R bar and D4 into R bar. D3 into R bar into D4 into R bar, where D3 and D4 are statistical constants. These are like the rules, thumb rule. We have a lot of thumb rule in our company, isn't it? Same way statistician have given this rule, you can use it. Similarly, to locate the control limit for X bar chart, the formula is X double bar plus or minus A2 into R bar, where A2 is again a statistical constant. The A2, D3, D4, all of them are based on the subgroup size. What is your subgroup size? 5. I picked it up from the table. These tables and all available in the manual. And it is available in any book, you will find them, right? These are called control chart constants. For a subgroup size of 5, A2 is 0.577, D3 is 0, D4 equal to 2.114. I will be using this. So now again, I'm going to the table. Now the data is tabulated. Now X bar is calculated here, 20 X bar, 20 ranges. How is this number calculated? 600.36. Add all the 5, divide by 5. Same way you can calculate all the other average. Now how to find the range within the 5?
Maximum minus
minus.
Yeah. What is the maximum you are seeing here within the 5?
It's not 1.6.
It's not 1.6.
Beautiful. What is the minimum you are seeing?
598.
Very good. The difference is 3.6 here. Same way, I want you to calculate all the averages, all the ranges. Now 20 averages, 20 ranges. With the 20 averages, you calculate the average of the averages. That's simple. Add all the 20, divide by 20. That is your X double bar. You know what is this X double bar? Center line.
Center line.
What is your customer target? 600. But what is your process target?
600.072.
Your process is targeting 600.072. but your customer is expecting 600 from you. You're seeing a problem, but that's okay because customer is going to accept it. Isn't it? Because customer anyway has given a tolerance, but slight shift is there. And range R bar is 2.72. Range will talk about the spread, the within batch variation, right? We'll talk about it. So now for you to plot the control chart, you take a graph sheet and R bar. First, you need to plot R chart. Don't plot the X bar chart first. First, you need to plot the R chart. Now the R bar is 2.72. I have some, the scaling. So slightly below 3, I have the R bar. R bar is drawn. Upper control limit is drawn. Lower control limit is drawn. Center line is ready. Upper control limit is ready. Lower control limit is ready. This is for range chart. How many ranges we have? 20 ranges. The first 20. One, second one, third one, so on. I plotted all 20. Now I'll take a scale, connect the first point with the second, and then second to third, it will go like this. So I connect everything. All are straight line. 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5. And now looking at the process and tell me, is that your R chart is under control or out of control?
Under control.
Under control.
And now tell me, what is the practical meaning of it? When R chart is under control, what do you understand?
All values are within the control limit.
Yes, all values are within the control limit. But how is it helpful for me in my business? I am producing some product. How I collected the data, I told you. Shift number 1, shift number 2, shift number 3, shift number 4.
Process is under control.
No, this is again a generic statement. Your statements are correct. I'm not denying your statements are correct. But what is this R chart is specifically telling you?
Spread out is more.
Every change of shift, there is a change of direction.
No, I have my friend Sanjay here. Sanjay want to share something. Yes, Sanjay.
Yes, sir. This is data seems to be collected within the group. For example, shift wise, if you are seeing. So from if I am considering my first shift, second shift or all shift I am considering, so I can see that my all product which is produced in the shift wise is within the control.
Very good.
Can see, I say it is reproducibility?
No, that is not reproducibility, that is repeatability. Right. See here, shift number 1, this point range is calculated from 5 data points you collected during shift number 1 on day number 1. If all the points are on the same shift, all the points should be close to each other. If all the points are close to each other, my R chart will be under control. If the points are not close to each other, what will happen? My range will be very wider. My range will be high. When the range becomes high, it may go out of control. When one of the range goes out of control, what does it mean? I am finding difficult to produce the same part within a particular shift. Now I am not eligible to compare what is happening in first shift and what is happening in second shift. I am not at all eligible. Am I right? If for me to be eligible to study what am I doing today and what am I doing tomorrow, my routine has to be same. Then only I will compare today and tomorrow. Right? So, but within a day, if my routine is completely different, then what is the point of me comparing today and tomorrow? Today I eat vegetarian and tomorrow I'm eating non-vegetarian. Right? So what we want to understand is, Within a shift, you have produced 5 parts. That you have produced so many, but 5 you took sample. All the 5 should be close to each other. If all the 5 are close to each other, the range will be smaller. If the range is smaller, you can say the within batch variation is under control. If you are not able to produce same parts within every shift, isn't it? And you will not be able to study the difference that may exist between your shift. All of you are with me on this?
Yes, sir.
Within batch variation should be under control. Then only you must proceed further to study what is that I am producing today and what is that I am producing tomorrow. I can compare. And I want same there also. See, what is required in your company? You want to produce 10,000 products. All 10,000 should be same, correct? All 10,000 same means very minor deviation. But can you produce all 10,000 in a single go within half an hour? No. You produce it over 10 days, 20 days. And then within a day, you produce it over shift. And every shift, people are changing. Every shift, you know, some raw materials are changing, isn't it? So there are two types of variation possible. Between variation, between batch variation, and within batch variation. You need to monitor both. So this R chart is monitoring within batch variation. Now within batch variation is under control. If within batch variation is under control, I will proceed to plot X bar chart. Otherwise, I will not plot. Even you should not plot, right? You plot the X bar chart only when R chart is under control. There is a statistical reason also. Now X double bar, upper control limit, lower control limit based on formula, we got it. Center line, upper control limit and lower control limit. First here, what I will plot? I will plot X bar. What is X bar? Average of the 5 samples you collected on shift number 1. That is here. That is here. Now, average of 5 points I collected on shift number 2. My expectation is both should be same. But there is some variation. But of course, it is under control. Similarly, I plot all the points. All the points are plotted, all 20. Now, as usual, I connect them. And now tell me, is this process under statistical control?
No, sir.
No.
One point is out of central.
One point is out of lower control limit. The point is sample number 8. What is sample number 8? Sample number 8 is collected on day number 2. Shift number 4. Now what I do is, I'll call my co-workers and go to the spot. This is called a Gemba. This is called Gemba. I call my team and then go to the spot. Shift number 4, day number 2. I will ask for the check sheet. Then I will go through the check sheet and then understand who is the operator, what raw material source is from where, what are the machine setting. There are many things. Why? I want to understand why it went wrong. This is called the Gemba. And whenever you get a point outside the control limit, you must immediately investigate. Do you think such an investigation is important, or do you really follow like how I am speaking now? Do you really go to the spot and then do investigation like this, like how a police department is functioning? And when something happens, then all of them, the nearest police station, SI, inspector, everybody goes to the spot. They mark, you know, a lot of circles they draw on the road and then they take pictures. Isn't it? Is it required in our company? Or shall we take it? Okay, what is there? Only one point. Come on.
No, it's what required, sir.
Is it really important to do the investigation or shall we take it lightly?
It is important.
It is important. Because when we take it lightly, what will happen? Sometime if you continue, actually here, you could see the remaining points are safe. So the general human psychology, particularly the Indian mindset is, they think this is okay. Chalo, only one point is there, came out. And now we have the target, delivery target. So produce. So what will happen if you don't understand and then if you continue immediately after 2-3 days, so many points will start falling out, isn't it? Maybe 3-4 points will fall out. And again, your delivery targets are important. Now what will happen? You are continuing again. Okay, leave it. 2-3 only you leave it. See, please note, it doesn't mean only one part gone wrong. One batch gone wrong. You need to understand. This is not one part. This is one batch. Now you ignored it. And after 3 days, 2-3 batches came out. Again, you ignored it. And now 4-5 batches came out. Again, if you ignore, what will happen? You will come out. Isn't it? Somebody will start questioning you. What is, how dare you can tolerate all these things. And this kind of habit and then this kind of approach and then if you produce everything and send it to the customer, customer will do some audit, isn't it? Will do some audit. You have sent an entire lot. Customer randomly, you know, will select certain batches, like a cluster sampling. He will select certain batches and then go for 100% inspection. And then these batch, the output from these batches are selected by your customer. Now what will happen? Your customer will send back the entire lot, isn't it? Because you may think this is one point, but actually this one point is representing one whole batch that is produced on a particular shift. Please note, a point going beyond control limit is a strong signal of a special cause. You should not consider this as a common cause. Clear? And now both, any questions? And now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, for this particular batch number 8, we have seen that the point has gone out of the control limit.
Yes.
But if we see the range for that particular batch, what can we conclude comparing range for that batch and the control?
The range is very good. Good question. The range is under control, but X bar is not under control. Range under control means your outputs are close to each other. Your outputs are close to each other. That means outputs are same. But if X bar is inside, your outputs are good. Outputs are same, but outputs are bad. But for 9, outputs are same and they are good. We want same. We want same and we want all good. Here all are same, but all are bad.
Yes.
All are same, all are bad.
Right.
It is a group of people copying the answer from each other. And final result is all are failing. That is also possible, isn't it? So we have to be careful. So all are same, that is good. But all are bad, that is wrong. So that's what we are seeing here. We want all to be same and we want all to be good. So that's why we always require 2 control chart. First thing is R chart should be under control. And then only you must construct the X bar chart. Why? Because the control limit formula in X bar chart is X double bar plus R minus A2 into R bar. Now what is R bar? R bar is picked up from here. You can pick up the R bar from here only when the chart is under control. Whenever the chart is not under control, that data is an outlier. This is an outlier. Outlier should not be included in any calculation. So if such a out of control point comes here, that's why I'm telling you, please don't plot the X bar chart at all. Don't plot the X bar chart when your R chart is out of control. But R chart is under control, then you plot. Now R chart is under control. I plotted the X bar chart. Still one point came out. It means my mean is shifting. My spread is okay. But my mean is shifting. My conclusion is correct. Suppose my R chart is out of control. And still I construct my X bar chart and see an output going beyond the control limit. It means I may be tempted to conclude that mean is shifting. But that may not be reality. Problem can happen by 2 ways. One is the central tendency not on the target. Another one is control limits are wider. Both way your product can get rejected. So here when R is under trouble, R chart is under trouble, first conclusion is control limits are wider. Right? That means the spread is more. The process spread is more. So immediately you fix the process for that. And then think about the X bar chart. Ultimately, both needs to be under control. Hope all of you understand. This is what is written here. I'm not going to read it out because I've already explained. And now there are several formulas exist. For X bar R chart, you can use whenever your subgroup size is less than 8. Use X bar R chart. And your data must be continuous. All of you know what is continuous data. when my subgroup size is more than 8, I'll go for X bar S chart, and slight changes in the formula. X bar chart is same, but your S chart, R chart will become S chart. Again, the rule is S chart must be plotted first, and then plot the X bar chart. And then if my subgroup size is only 1, for example, the taking more sample is not economical, or it is a destructive testing, I cannot destruct so many parts. Certain conditions, you have to choose only one. That moment you can go for IMR chart, right? And again, the formulas are there. Don't worry about the formulas. Anytime you wanted to memorize the formula, you can memorize, but that is not required. You can just do it in Minitab, or you can ask somebody to do it for you. And now the X bar R chart monitors the mean as well as the variation when my subgroup size is less than 8. A point falling outside the control limit, as a statistician, as a green belt, as a black belt, I know it is a strong signal of a special cause. I should be there enough to stop the process and then investigate the process, because I know it is not one point, it is one full batch. It is not one point, it is one full batch, and so my attention is required. I need to study the process and correct it. If I am not doing it, I am not giving justice to my job. So any special cause, process must be stopped and then fixed. This is also called stop to fix, right? People call it stop to fix. So when my X bar, when my subgroup size is more than 8, I go for the X bar S chart. R chart must be in control to interpret the X bar chart. Otherwise, I don't even look at the X bar chart. When R chart is in control, my X bar chart going out of control means me, it's a real signal. My mean is shifting, right? But when my R chart is not in control, my control limit calculated in the X bar chart will definitely wrong, because my R is wrong already. Range is calculated using an outlier. That itself is wrong. So don't use that range for calculating the control limit in your X bar chart. And these are the center lines, and these are the control limits in our range chart. And next is attribute data, right? And now please note, I hope all of you understood what is that X bar chart and R chart are doing in our manufacturing process, or in our service process, whatever it is.
Sir, one question, can I?
Yeah. Yes, please.
Yeah. Actually, for our normal condition, our 99.7 data should be within our control limit. But my question is about 0.27% data. For example, if I'm plotting that 100 data, so there is a chance of 3 data will be go out of control. Correct, sir?
Yes.
Yeah. Right. So should I consider that 3 points as assignable causes, or should I consider as a process is normal only?
All right. Good question. So, if my point is outside the control limit, you need to tell me, you need to tell me what is that point. That point is X bar, or that point is range.
That it is from IMR chart.
Let us say, you can use it in any chart. Let us say it is X bar. X bar means what is your subgroup size?
We can consider 5.
5. Using 5 samples, I calculated the average. That average is falling outside the control limit. All right?
Yes.
What is the chance? Correct. What is the chance of a point to go beyond control limit? You said 0.27. You said 0.27, right? So 0.27 means when I select 5 parts repeatedly, do you think all 5 can go outside control limit?
No, it won't.
So absolutely there is no chance to get a point. I cannot say there is no chance. There is very less chance. See, always we conclude, we take conclusion only with 95% confidence. We can always be wrong in 5% of the time. This is statistics. This is not mathematics.
Yes.
So this is statistics. So we make a conclusion process is out of control, but your process may be under control. But we will conclude that process is out of control, but your process may still be under control. But the chance for you to go wrong is only less than 5%. Right? So this is a rule. Yes, yes. So we always escape from all our decisions saying that we are confident 95%. Right? Got it.
Yeah. This is, sir, actually, I have done one R&D. I have generated the random data only. And I plotted eye chart for that. And right. For that 1000 data points, it is around 4 data points was out of control. So that's why this question came
in. That's fine. That means it is only.
So it is within control only.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. But any number of points, see, when you are trying to baseline a process, if you see a point going outside the control limit, but you wanted to baseline the process, what is baseline? You want to know where is your process as of now. And you must eliminate the out of control points. If there are 1000 data and then 4 data are outside the control limit, then those 4 you should not consider for calculation of baseline. Right?
All
right. Remaining 996 data you can use and you can make a conclusion, but not the 4. That 4 should be actually should be ignored. But in real time, they should be fixed because they are all special causes. All right. So 1 minute.
All right.
Okay. Let us go for a mini tab right now. Stop sharing. So all of you see my mini tab screen? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Very good. Now I open a worksheet, another worksheet, because I wanted to show you the same case. So I got the same case. You see the length data, 100 data, what we discussed is available here, 100 data. 100 means every 5 is a subgroup. That means there are 20 subgroup, but all the data are recorded in a single column. And now I can plot it manually with a graph sheet and then a sketch pen and other things. Or otherwise, I go to stat, I go to control chart, and this is a variable chart. Continuous data are also called variable data. So X bar R chart, I click all these things. Now my data in one column, and now where I click here, where is the data? Column number 1, I select that. And what is my subgroup size? It is 5. Now I give OK. Now my job is done. Right? Very simple. So go to stat, control chart, variable chart for subgroup, and it is X bar R. And I can select how I keyed the data. It is everything in one column. And then I come here. It is asking where is your data. I select it. And then here I give the subgroup. And then subgroup is given. I give OK. Now chart is plotted. Right? And now, and see here, and also in control charts, when I go to control chart, subgroup, X bar R chart, there is something called option. Within the option, there are testing. See here, I have self-tested only one condition. I have tested only one condition, but I can always test all conditions. I will find out how my son is behaving. When he comes late on a Monday, it could be a reason. When he comes late on a Friday, it could be some other reason. Am I right? When he wakes up late in the early morning, that could be some other reason. When he says stomach is paining, that could be another reason. I know about my son, and so I have so many signals. Same way, if you know about your process, you will have so many signals. One signal what we understood is a point going beyond 3 sigma limit. There are other signals, those testings, it depends on the maturity level. It depends on the maturity level, right? We know everything about our children. And so when our children are trying to do anything wrong, we detect it upfront, isn't it? We detect it upfront. One day they don't take the breakfast, then we immediately understand, oh, he is trying to do something or otherwise he is unhealthy. Some clue we are getting. Same way, when something happens in my process gives a signal. We should be able to understand. That comes out of the experience. That experience, when you put it in a paper, that is called a control plan. You are the best person to control your child. Am I right? You are the best person to control your child. Same way, you are the best person to control your process also. You write everything in a document and make somebody to monitor that. And now your process is under complete care. That document is called what? Control plan. How to collect the sample, how many sample I should collect, which control chart I should plot. And if a point goes above upper control limit, what does it mean? If a point goes below lower control limit, what does it mean? You pass on entire knowledge. That document is called what? Control plan. Somebody can blindly follow your guidelines, your process will produce fantastic results. Because you are not giving it just like that. You are putting all your experience in a piece of paper. Your 10 years of experience or 10 months of experience on the project, you are putting it in a piece of paper. That is called control plan. Hope all of you understand the meaning of control plan, right? And now, we move on to talk about the other charts. Control charts for attribute data. Attribute can be defect. Attribute can be defective. I hope all of you know the difference between defect and defective. We spoke enough. And for defective, you have two types of chart, P chart and NP chart. And for defects, you have two types, C chart and U chart. Under each category, you have two types based on the sample size or subgroup size. If the subgroup size is fixed, in this category, you can go for NP chart. In defect category, if the subgroup size is fixed, I will go for C chart. For example, the number of students failing in our green belt examination. Number of students failing in a green belt examination. Now tell me, is it a defect or a defective?
Defective.
Defect. So you are here. So now you can use P chart or you can use NP chart. You understand? Defective. So you can use P chart or NP chart. And number of students enrolling batch by batch. Is it a fixed number or variable number?
Variable.
So you have to plot P chart. If you are a teacher who want to monitor the proportion of students who are failing in your class, maybe batch on batch or year on year, some category. And if the number of students are supposed to vary, then you can go for P chart. Similarly, you are monitoring defectives in your company and your sample size. One day you take 10 sample, another day you take 5 sample, another day you take 100 sample, or everything you produced, the production unit can be the sample. One day you produce 1,000, other day you produce 800, other day you produce 900, then you will go for P chart. All right. And now similarly, the attendance, is it a defect or a defective? 1 hour you are not present in the class. Is it a defect? It's a defect. Right? Attendance, your student not present in 1 hour of the class. That's a defect. That means you are here now. You are not here. And you wanted to monitor the defects. And now there are so many classes. You are the principal. You wanted to monitor. And every class, the number of student absence you are seeing. And now every class size is, you know, exactly 60. Because your admission policy is like that. Every class, the size is 60. That means your subgroup size is fixed. Now what is your option? C chart. But if the student's admission is varying, you really don't have exact number of students, then you will go for U chart, right? And that's how you can select, and the formulas are there on the other side. You don't have to memorize any formula because softwares are going to manage it. And now you know the difference between defect and defective. And now let us take a case. The call center want to assess whether its call answering system is in control. call center, right? And you are the manager. And the total number of incoming calls and number of unanswered calls were recorded for 21 days. And if a call is unanswered, that is a defective. Call center means they have to answer every call, isn't it? Customers are calling and they are not doing. That's a defective. And what is your comment about the number of calls a call center may get? Will it be a fixed number or it can vary?
Vary.
Very, very.
So what control chart do you recommend for this situation?
P chart.
That is what is plotted here. Now, what do you see? Your process is under control. Under control, on an average, 9.5% of the calls are dropped. On an average, 9.5% of the calls are dropped. And now your control chart is telling you, you are now in a good position to train your team, or equip the system in a better manner, thereby 9.5% can come down to 2.5%. People are following your procedure only. People are listening. Your system is so good, and that is why, you know, at least there is a problem, I agree, but the problem level is consistent. And now you conduct a training, motivate the people, give them some rewards, awards, incentives, 9.5 will come down, right? So control chart gives a clue whether your company is ready for the next level of performance or not. Most of the Six Sigma projects fail. Most of the research projects fail because they try to improve an unstable process. Process is unstable and you are putting your energy to improve it. Do you think improvement will happen? It will not happen, right? First of all, standardization, stability is important. Again, the same procedure, I'm not going to read it out. And now all these things we will see in Minitab. In no time, Minitab will throw away the control charts, right? An inspection process checked parts, produced for defectives. It is very clear it is defective. The total number of parts produced vary every shift. Because every shift, the number of parts produced is varying. And the number of defectives were recorded for 24 shift. And is the process under control or not? And tell me, what is the situation? Will you go for a P chart or a C chart or a U chart or a NP chart?
P chart.
Beautiful. It's a defective and the subgroup size is variable. So go for the P chart. And what is your inference? Process. The number of defectives.
Process not stable, some areas.
Not stable.
Yeah. The number of defectives are not under control. Now, you should not say 8.2% is the rejection. You should not say. 8.2% is the rejection. You are not supposed to say. Why? Because you have outliers. The outliers are included in this 8.2%. Clear? So, for calculation purpose, you can skip. But in real time, you have to find out the reason why this gone out and fix it in real time. And that will be the real baseline. Clear? Because this is somewhere around 12.5% it is. But you are saying that it is 8.2%. Got it? So outlier should be always excluded in your conclusion. Don't take decisions including the outliers, right? A manufacturer of smartphones want to assess whether the process is in control. Samples of mobiles were taken every hour for three shift. And tested to see whether they work. Defectives are mobiles that do not pass the test. And now what is that you are monitoring? Defects or defectives?
Defectives.
You are monitoring something, but finally what you record in your check sheet is the number of phones that do not work. That means it is defective, right? But the number of phones you are taking the sample, that you have to look at the data, but I will help you because I have already seen the data. Then I'm always sample of, let's say, 100 phones are tested. Every batch, 100 phones. That means subgroup size is fixed. Now, what kind of control chart you need to plot?
NP chart.
Beautiful. When you plot NP chart, you will see your control limit, a single line. Here, can you see your control limit itself going up and down? Why? Because your sample size is varying, so control limit will also be varying. It will be a very hectic job for you to plot this manually. For 24 points, you have to have 24 calculation for upper control limit and 24 calculation for lower control limit. So definitely don't plot it manually, but you should know what is this control chart and all about. All right. And now, a quality team of a company started an improvement project to try to reduce the number of incorrect invoices that is being issued to its customer. Number of incorrect invoices. All right. The number of defects for every day is recorded. What is number of defect? If the amount is wrong, client name is wrong, the invoice is completely wrong. Isn't it? Amount is wrong, customer address and name is wrong, completely wrong. But my invoice, no, some spelling mistake is there, but still it is okay. That means that's a defect. What is that you are monitoring? The number of defects for every day is recorded. In every day, you might produce, you might generate, you know, 100 invoice. But with all, after noticing all the 100 invoice, what is that you are recording? The number of defects. Are you monitoring defects or you are monitoring defectives?
Defects.
I am monitoring defects. It is clearly given. The number of defects for every day is recorded. And so, what will I plot? I will plot either C chart or I will plot U chart. Now, when will I go for C chart? When the number of subgroups is constant. When I make same number of invoices every day, then I will go for C chart. But when I make different number of invoices, I will go for U chart. So here, the invoices are, you know, different numbers. So I am going for a U chart. See here, your control limit is also going up and down. Hectic job. On the other hand, a process excellence team in a bank inspect transaction. There are 7 opportunities for error in each transaction. For every transaction to fail, there are 7 opportunities. 100 transactions are inspected every day. Number of errors are recorded. Now, is the process under control or not? Now, what do you check? Do you check defect or defective now?
Defects.
Defects. And then, is that your sample size or subgroup size is constant or variable?
Yeah, fixed.
Fixed. So, what is the control chart you need to plot?
C chart.
Very good. So C chart is plotted. Your sample size is fixed. You are seeing a fixed line and the number of defects are not under control. Right? You can try to control it. So we discussed all these things. I'm not going to read it out for the interest of time. So there are types of data. Data can be continuous. Data is continuous or data can be discrete or attribute. In continuous, we have seen 3 chart. In attribute or discrete, we have seen 4 chart. If you gain adequate knowledge about the process, you will be the best person to create a control plan for your company. Right? Control plan is not something, you know, suddenly some experts can give. It is the document that talks about the nature of the process. If you are putting your child in your relative's house for 10 days, how many instruction you will give? So many instruction you will give, right? See, he won't eat. So many things you will tell. He likes milk, he likes curd, and he likes sweet. And there are many things you give. Because you know him very well. And all 10 days, they will follow your instruction. So your child is, taken care of. Same way, in your absence, somebody need to take care of your process. Am I correct or not? So you are creating a plan. And then if something goes wrong, what is to be done? Sometimes you will also tell, some remedy, quick remedies you will have, that also you pass on. So all the experience you will be sharing, that is nothing but control plan. Now you open any control plan document and read it, it will be nothing. It is based on their experience. There is no rigid rule for anything. You can create your own plan. And now, again, the rules are not common. Rules are made by us. For example, the kind of rules you have in your house will be different. The kind of rules I have in my house will be completely different. Am I correct? I cannot say there is a common rule. 9 o'clock, everybody should sleep. No. In your house, it may be 10 o'clock. In somebody's house, it may be 8 o'clock. Isn't it? It all depends on what they do. Similarly, these rules, control chart rules, are also cannot be common and cannot be applicable everywhere. For your company, you need to customize and use it. But the general one, we will see. First rule, if a point goes out of control limit, that's a strong signal for a special cause. Correct? That we have discussed. This is definitely a special cause. And 9 points in a row on same side of the center line. 9 points in a row on same side of the center line. All the points are always below. Whenever there is a non-random pattern. Random pattern means uncommentable. Non-random pattern means commentable. If somebody can talk about your child, that is definitely a black mark, isn't it? Your teacher is finding your behavior of the child, your child, and then giving a remark. He is always talkative. That is definitely serious, isn't it? Same way, make your process behavior uncommentable. If it is commentable, definitely there is a problem. You need to look at it. See here, all the points are well inside the control limit, but still you are finding a problem. This is called real maturity. This is called real experience. Got it? All the points are inside the control limit only, but still you are finding a problem. Do you really matured enough to listen to your process signal under such conditions? This is something like all the students are sitting inside your classroom, but they are listening to a smartphone, not to you. They keep the phone under the desk and then they are watching the movie. But all of them are inside the class only. Do you understand? All the points are inside the control limit, but still there is a specific pattern. If you don't notice and then don't control it, what will happen? This trend will drag your process to somewhere outside. Got it? So no? Fine.
Yeah.
And then 6 points in a row, all increasing or decreasing, something like this. Continuously 6 points are going up. This is again a commentable situation, a non-random pattern. What is preferred is a random pattern. And this is 14 points in a row. See, in my opinion, you don't have to bygot all these things. You write your own rules. Whatever you know about your process, based on that, you write few conditions. You check those conditions. Once you mature further, add on conditions. It is not necessary that you have to use all the Nelson rule. Nelson rules are applicable only for Nelson & Co, not for your company. For your company, your process, you have to come out. And now 2 out of 3 points beyond 2 sigma limit. 2 out of 3 points beyond 2 sigma limit. Because 2 sigma limits are warning limit. When your points are frequently crossing the warning limit, they are about to cross the control limit, right? So some clue. 4 out of 5 points above 1 sigma. They're seeing 4 out of 5 points above 1 sigma. Still they are under the control limit, but that's a signal. 15 points in a row within 1 sigma. Everything is around the target only. Everything is around the target, only slight up and down. That is also a problem. All the students are scoring exactly 80 mark. That's definitely a problem. You know what is the problem? All of them are sitting together and writing the exam. Right? So, everything around the target, that is also a special cause. Right? There is a pattern. There is a specific pattern exhibited by your process. It cannot happen just like that. That is the thing. And now finally, eight points in a row. In a row above 1 sigma. These are all certain findings and suggestions of Nelson & Co. And finally, from all this experience, we have come out with a documentation. we are handing over a child in our relative's house with all these additional conditions. What he will eat in the morning, what he will eat in the afternoon, what he will eat in the night. If he doesn't eat in the night, then how you have to take care, how to make him sleep and how to make him wake up. Everything is here. Clear? If he doesn't wake up 7 o'clock, then what are you supposed to do? Whether you have to pour a cup of water or you just have to beat him gently, all these things, you know, you are writing. So data collection plan, response reaction plan, everything is written. And this is a typical control plan. You can, if you have time, you can go through that. And so many things are written. Why they write like this, so much things? The process is very important to them. The process is very important to them, and so they write so much, right? And you can see you also behaving in like this when something becomes very critical to you, isn't it? Okay, that's all about control chart. And what we can do is we can now go to the mini tab. So let me open the file. Already I have one file opened, defectives. Now you are good at control. All of you are good now with respect to the control chart? Very good. It's my, okay. So again, I'm showing my Minitab screen. It is visible, I hope. Parts produced is given in column number 1. A number of defectives are typed in column number 2. Tell me what control chart I should plot now. Defectives and then parts produced.
P chart.
Beautiful. The defectives. So go to stat, go to control chart, attribute chart, which is P chart. And now the number of defectives here, and where is the subgroup is given in column number 1. I select that. Now I give OK. Job is done. Oh, it's taking more than. Do you see? 20, whatever is the number of sample, 24 sample. 24 upper control limit, 24 lower control limit, everything calculated in 2.4 second, and then graph is plotted. Now you can right click and you can append the graph to your report. You can send it to your Microsoft Word. You can send it to your PowerPoint, and immediately presentation is ready. When I click this, I will see it in my PowerPoint. Plot it, present it. Very simple, right? So this is done. And now, incorrect invoice. Let us open this case. Incorrect invoice. Takes some time. I stop and share it again. Now it is incorrect invoice. This is again defective. Or I will share my entire screen. That will be easier. This is one thing. Do you see incorrect invoice? Invoice and incorrect invoice. Do you see it?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So now tell me, what should I plot? Number of incorrect invoices. And then this side I have okay, tell me now, what is your opinion? Forget about the problem I've shown in the slide. Now look at the data and tell me. Incorrect invoice means what is it?
Defective.
Defect.
Incorrect invoice.
Defective.
Defective. Defective.
Incorrect invoice is defective. So subgroup size, is it fixed or variable?
Variable.
Now tell me, defective
P chart
and it is variable. That means you're right. P chart, right?
P chart.
When it is constant, I will go for NP.
NP chart.
NP chart.
Right now it is P chart. So again, I go to stat, control chart. I go to attribute chart. And again, I go to P chart. I just have to give the defective and then subgroup size in column one.
Invoices.
That's all. Now my chart is plotted. Right. It's done. Now, smartphone case. See, we need to know what are we doing. We need to know what are we plotting. When we are plotting, you know, defect, then we can have an option. So now defective phones are here, subgroup size is here. Now tell me, what is that we are dealing, defect or defective? We are dealing?
Defective.
Defective. And subgroup size is fixed or variable?
Fixed.
And so what is that I should do now?
NP.
NP chart.
Very good, NP. Go to stat, control chart. Attribute chart,
short.
NP, defective phone, subgroup size here, 300, I give OK. I'll get a straight line. You see here, control limit, upper control, lower control. And finally, transaction. So number of transaction is discrete data or attribute data. But transaction time is continuous data. And now, errors are monitored. Errors means, error means what? Defect or defective? Error defect. Means?
Defect.
Very good. Error means defect. Defect. And tell me, subgroup size fixed or variable?
Fixed.
So what is the chart I should use? C or U?
C.
Very good. So go to stat, go to control chart, attribute chart, go to C, variable is error. It is not even asking you the, you know, the subgroup size because it is fixed. Give OK, work is done. Now all the seven control chart we discussed. Any questions? Now control chart is over. That means control phase also over. Because all remaining are just, you know, mere documentation. Documentation and then create a control plan, hand over the process, celebrate the success. Celebrating success is important, isn't it? When we celebrate success, people will be motivated. Then many people will try to do projects. They will, improvement becomes easier. If you don't celebrate the success, rather only, you know, give tension to the people, then nobody will work on improvement projects. So this is my plan. I think I'm on time. It's very, you know,